Good day, everyone. We're going to be doing proofs. We're on page 16, number 1. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. Okay, so on this one right here, let me just move that just so. All right, let's get started. All right, so on page 16, number 1, they said that PQ, so 2 of PQ is equal to PR, and we need to prove that Q is the midpoint of P to R. Now, there's only one given, so that makes our life really easy. So we're going to say whatever this is right here, that's our given. And that one says it right here. 2PQ is equal to PR. So that was wicked simple. On top of that, what we're trying to prove is always the last statement that we're going to make. So Q is the midpoint of P to R. That's what we're trying to get to. So that will be your last statement. So Q is the midpoint of P to R. Right there, we have two things done out of the 5. Excellent. All right, so now as you go, you want to label your picture as we go. Now, as of so far, they've told us that 2 PQs are equal to 1 PR. So PR is all the way across. It's all the way across here. So all the way across is the same thing as 2 PQs. Now, completely separate from that, they said the segment addition postulate, which basically means that the left plus the right equals the whole shebang. That is what that is. So PQ plus QR is equal to the whole shebang PR. That is what the segment addition postulate is. And that says it right here. PQ plus QR equals PR. And we're going to click that right there. So at this moment, we know that the left plus the right equals the whole shebang. And also, we also know that the whole shebang, PR, so all the way across, is also equal to 2PQ. And look, right here, they said 2PQ, which is right here, is equal to PQ plus QR. Now, what does that happen to do with what we're doing? Well, all they did was PR is equal to PR. That's basically what we're saying. We replace those with these. So technically, that's the transitive. So transitive property basically says if A equals B and B equals C, you basically cut out the middleman and A would equal C. That's the transitive property. But that is not on our list. So what would be something else we could call that? And that would be substitution. Basically, what we're saying is that a second ago, we said PQ plus QR is equal to PR. We also know that PR is the same thing as saying 2PQ. So PQ plus QR is the same thing as, and instead of PR, we're going to say 2PQ. They just put these two, the left and the right. They said the right and the left, so that's totally fine. But basically, we just replaced that, and that's called substitution. We just wrote it backwards from what they gave to us. Excellent. Okay, so now that we have that, and I'm going to switch what sides that is. So I'm going to put that over here. So a second ago, we had PQ plus QR equals 2PQ. But really, if I just switch sides, that's 2PQ is equal to PQ plus QR. All I did was switch the sides, and that gave me the same thing as this. All right, now what changed from here to here? Well, this had 2PQs, and now that's just 1PQ. And this had PQ and QR, and now it's just QR. What disappeared from both of them? What disappeared was that they just took away one of the PQs. And we're left with 1PQ is equal to QR. So what did we do to get that? We subtracted. So it wasn't definition of midpoint. It wasn't symmetry. It was subtraction. So they subtracted that from both sides. And we got everything. That's awesome. All right, so let's go ahead and go to the next problem. Okay, I'm going to zoom out a little bit. There we go. Okay, so on this problem, just shifting down here a little bit, right here. Okay, so we want to make sure that we are labeling as we go. All right, so here we go. M is the midpoint of L to N. N is also the midpoint of M to O. And what we're trying to prove is LM is equal to NO. All right. All this stuff. So we know for a fact that the last thing that we're always going to say is what we're trying to prove. That's the easiest thing to put in here. So before I even click on this, one of my options will be that LM is congruent to NO. And LM is congruent to NO. So boom, that is right there. Now there's two different givens. So we're going to have both these givens, and they may be in order, they may be out of order. So let's just go with what they tell us. M is the midpoint of L to N. That was right here, so that is a given. So always put your givens first and what they feed into, and the last thing you always say is what you're trying to prove. Prove will never be a reason, but what you're trying to prove will always be on there. All right, so M is the midpoint of LN. All right, so here we go. So here is M. It is the midpoint of this line right here. Now, if this is the midpoint, what does that tell you? Well, that feeds into this idea. LM is equal to MN. So as soon as they tell us that these two things are equal, you always mark your picture. So this is equal to this. And that's what that notch means. That single notch means that this side is equal to that side. And that was midpoint. What was said for that to happen? We said the word midpoint, and that's the definition of midpoint. Those two things would be equal to each other. And then they say the other given. Well, what was the other given? The other given was N was the midpoint of MO. And there it is right here. N is the midpoint of MO. Now, from that, as soon as they say N is the midpoint, so N is the midpoint of M to O, so that's the midpoint from here to here, right? So that's the midpoint. That means that this side would be equal to this side. And that's what they said. MN right here is equal to NO. Now there's already a single notch here. So that means that over here will also be a single notch. So I'm going to put this right there. And how did we know that? What magical word was said for that to happen? And that magical word was the word midpoint. So there it is. Definition of midpoint. Boom. Okay, then the transitive property. Okay, so as of so far, we have said that LM is equal to MN, and there's my and button, MN is equal to NO. So we have both of these things happening, right? All right, so that means that we get to cut out the middle man. That's the transitive property. So if Remember what we said before, if A equals B and B equals C, then A equals C, just like we said up here. As soon as I find it. Yeah. So we cut out the middle man, and we know that A would be equal to C, right? Well, in this case, we cut out the middle man. We know that LM right here is equal to NO, which is right here. So this side is equal to this side. And where's that on here? Let's see. LM is equal to NO. And even if you weren't sure, if you go through this, which one makes sense? Does MN equal ON? Well, that's still a possibility, but that's not the transitive property. Does MN equal itself? Well, once again, that's not the transitive property. That's a reflexive property. And does LM equal NO? Yeah, because we cut out that middleman. So you could at least narrow it down. And look, we answered all the questions. All right, let's go down to the next problem. All right, so on this next problem, let me just move this around just a little bit. Here we go. All right, so on this problem right here, as soon as I get my picture just so, so on this picture, we have, so we always know that our givens are what we're going to do first, and our last thing that we're definitely going to do is what we're trying to prove. All right, so let's see. The last thing we're trying to prove, R is midpoint of ST and UV. Well, actually, that's what we're trying to do. Prove is never a reason, and R is the midpoint, R is the middle. That doesn't make sense. But this is what we're trying to prove. R is the midpoint of ST and R is the midpoint of UV. Well, this is the only one that makes sense. And prove is never a reason, so that's definitely not right. Okay, so let's go back. Okay, SR is equal to RT. Why is that? Because that was given to us. And as soon as we say that things are equal, we automatically mark our picture. So SR, boop, is equal to RT, boop. And we knew that because it was given, and we do single notches. All right, next part. So prove is never a reason, given. Well, that's a reason, not what we're trying to do. So R is the midpoint of S to T. Da-na-na-na-na-na. Okay, so this and this don't make sense. This is the only one that makes sense. Because prove and given can never be statements. So does this make sense? R is the midpoint of S to T? Is R the midpoint of S to T? Yeah. How did we know that? Because these two sides were equal to each other. So that's the only thing. Hey, guess what? We actually proved one of our things that we were trying to prove. That's awesome. All right, let's keep going. The next thing they said on number three right here, that SR is equal to UR. Okay, we just said things are equal. So let's actually mark it. Well, if this is already single notch, then this will also be a single notch. And how did we know that? That was given to us right up here. And they also said that RT is equal to RV. Well, RT is already a single notch, so that means that RV is also a single notch. And we know both of those because it was given. Next. Okay, because of substitution. So what are we trying to prove right now? So we've already proved that R is a midpoint of S to T. We now don't need to prove U to V, that this is the midpoint of this. So we already checked this one out. Boop. This is the only thing we're missing. So what we're trying to prove, I'll zoom out a little bit, is we're trying to prove that UR is equal to RV. And these letters might be backwards. So that's okay. Just as long as the left is equal to right or the right is equal to left, we're okay. All right, so here we go. Is UR equal to RV? Actually, we got it right the first time. Let's see if the other ones are better. SR is equal to RV. That's not what we're trying to prove. We're trying to prove that this is the midpoint of this line. So it's definitely not this option. And RT is equal to RV. And that's not what we're trying to prove this right here. So the only one that worked was this. And now that we have successfully proven that these two are equal to each other. All right, sweet. And that these are equal to each other, so thus that this is the midpoint. Excellent. Okay, the other thing that they said substitution is RV. RV is equal to RT right here. So these, we cut out the middleman right here. That's basically what's going on. We're trying to prove that UR is equal to RV. Oh, right there. That's what we're supposed to do. So this one and the first statement, when you cut out the middleman, everything would work out. So there's a lot of middlemans here. Okay. Anyway, so we got that one done. Let's go down to the next problem. Okay. Boop. All right. So now we're on page 17, number 5. So page 17, number 5. Let me move this around just a little bit. All right. Put this just so. All right. Now we know the first thing is always what we're trying to are given, and the last thing is what we're trying to prove. So what we're trying to prove is 2 is equal to 3. So 2 is equal to 3. Angle 2 is equal to angle 3. That's our last thing. Awesome. The first thing we're doing is what they were gave to us, which is right there. Excellent. Now they said that ray DB. So DB. So this right here cut ADC. So this right here, this angle got cut in half. So if an angle got cut in half, then you have two little angles that are equal to each other. So let's see. Does angle 1 equal 3? Nope. Because we cut this red in half. So that means the left is equal to the right. So it's not that one. How about 2 and 1? Yep, that works. So angle 1 and 2 are equal to each other. So, or 2 and 1 are equal to each other. And what was the magical word for that to happen? Bisect. What kind of bisect? Angle bisecting. So angle bisector was the key word that was said for this to happen. The next thing, what else do we know? Does angle 1 equal, so 1 plus 2 equals 3, 1 plus 2 equals 3? Nope, that's not right. 1 and 3 are vertical? Well, that's true. And 2 and 3 are vertical? That's not true. So 1 and 2 are vertical, that's the only one that checks out. 1 and 3. 1 and 3 are vertical. And what's vertical angles? That's this. This and this are vertical, or it could have been this right here. This and this are vertical. Ms. Holland, that is horizontal. Well, if you turn your paper, guess what? Now they are vertical. So if it doesn't look make sense in geometry, just turn your paper. It'll probably make more sense later. So those are vertical angles. So those are vertical. Anyway, so 1 and 3 are vertical angles. How do you know that? Because that's a vertical angles theorem right there. Okay, next. We know that now what was for this to happen, for one of these things to happen, what fed into that? So look, we just said vertical angles, and vertical angles mean that they are equal to each other. So 1 and 3 would be equal to each other. And what was said for that to happen? That would be the definition of vertical angles. So the vertical angles theorem was saying, hey, these two would be vertical angles. But because the definition of vertical angles, they are equal to each other. As long as we have the keyword vertical, we'd be able to solve this. All right, so we know that this and this are equal. So if this is already a single angle, then this is also a single angle. And by single, I mean that they have one loop on there, such as this would have one loop and this would have two loops. So these two are equal, and this is a second set of angles that are equal to each other. So this already had a single set, so that would also be a single set. And in addition to that, we know that 2 and 3 are equal to each other because of the transitive property. So if 1 equals 2 and 1 equals 3, cut out the middle man, we know that 2 and 3 are equal because of the transitive property. And that's number 4. That's question number 4, but that's page 17, number 5. Okay, let's go to the next problem. Okay, so we're on number 6. Let me move this just so. All right, so on this problem right here, we know that the first thing we always do is all of our givens, but the last thing is always what we're trying to prove. All right, let's see. Angle 1 is congruent to angle 4. Okay, how did we know that? Well, that was given to us, wasn't it? And as soon as they say things are equal, mark up your paper. So 1, boop, is equal to 4. And I put single angles on there. Okay, so they're congruent, so that means that they're equal to each other. So 1 is equal to 4. That's really simple because the definition is congruent, of congruence. So if they're congruent, then they're also equal. All right, what was the another given? 1 is equal to 5. 1 and 5 are supplementary? No, that was what we're trying to prove. 1 and 4 are congruent? Well, we already did that one, didn't we? And then 4 and 5 form a linear pair. Okay, so that was the second given. Awesome. Boom. Okay, so did we say anything is equal? No, nothing yet. Okay, then they say 4 and 5 are supplementary. Now, this fed in, our given fed into this. What was said a second ago about 4 and 5 that made this happen? Well, that would be either complementary. No, that makes 90. Supplementary, that makes 180. Yep. Or vertical angles, supplementary. Because that is the supplement theorem, meaning if it's a linear pair, it's automatically supplement. Well, we just know that these two make 180 degrees. That's good. Next, definition of supplementary angles. All right, well, let's see. We're talking about 4 and 5, right? So 4 and 5 make how many degrees? Makes 180. And then substitution, let's see, what do we got here? Well, what are we trying to create? 4 and 5, right? Ooh, that's a typo. I'll have that fixed for you guys. So we're trying to prove that 1 and 5 are supplementary. So what we have here is that we have, so just a little typo there, we're trying to prove that this and this are equal. And then these two right here make 180 degrees. So if we already know that 4 and 5 add up to 180, well, if 1 is the same thing as 4, that would be 1 and 5 make 180. And what did we do? We got that by doing 1 and 5 are 180 degrees. And then angle 1 and 5 will be supplementary because that's a definition of supplementary angles. All right, so ignoring this little typo right there, that's what we're supposed to do. Sweet. All right. Let's go ahead and do page 20, number 1. All right, so the first thing they said was that angle PQR is a right angle. So PQR, so that's a right angle. And that was given to us right there. Boom. So that's an easy given. And the last thing we're going to do is say that these angles, so PQS and SQR, are complementary. And we don't know the reason yet, but it's 100% is not going to be proved. So I know that for a fact. All right, so let's just go down our list. So let's see. So we know that this entire angle right here is complementary. So that means that that entire angle is 90 degrees. Now, how do we know that? And that would be the definition of complementary angles or the definition of a right angle or perpendicular. Okay, what was the magical word said for this to happen? What was the magical word? And that was right angle, or in this case, phrase, right? So that would be the definition of right angle. Yes, complementary, yes, perpendicular, but right angle was the key word, so that's what we're going to use. Next, they said that these two angles, PQS and SQR, are equal to the whole shebang, PQR. Well, how do we know that? Well, that's angle addition. So is it just addition or angle addition? There was no transitive. There was no cutting out the middleman because there's not enough stuff yet. So the only thing that makes sense is angle addition. And then they said PQS and angle SQR equaled 90. So we know that this and this equals the whole shebang, right? So we know that this is 90. All right, we know from that was our second thing. So this entire measurement is 90 degrees. We also know that these two angles add up to angle PQR. And we now know that those two angles add up to 90. Now, what happened? Either that would be substitution, or better yet, you cut out the middleman, you got transitive. So substitution is not on here. Transitive is the better choice because we know from earlier that angle PQR is equal to 90. We also know that angle PQS plus angle SQR is equal to the whole shebang angle PQR, right? This is me just explaining it. You don't have to write this down. Well, we know that PQR can be replaced with this, right? So cut out the middle man and you're left with this equals this. So that would be transitive property. Awesome. And finally, we also know that PQS and angle SQR are complementary. Now, how do you know that? What was the key thing that happened right there? Well, we know that a complementary means that those angles add up to 90. Well, that would be the definition of complementary. So not supplementary, that makes 180. So it's between these two, definition of right angle or definition of complementary angles. Well, we're talking about two angles. We're talking about multiple angles. So that should be your clue, because definition of right angle is only one angle. We're talking about two angles. So that would have to be plural. So that would be your key thing. So you can definitely use the English language to help you figure that out, which is awesome. All right, let's keep going. Number 7, which in this case is page 20, number 2. All right, so we're doing this one right here. Okay, now the first thing we always do is our givens. So they said angle, angle 2 is congruent to angle 3. How do we know that? That was given to us. And then they said angle 2, well, that's congruent, right? Well, that's angle 2 is equal to angle 3. Now, how do we know that? Because that is a definition of congruence. So if they're congruent, that means that they're also equal. So that's helpful. And then angle 1 is and 2 are linear pair. Well, that was given to us. Boom. So I always try to figure out what the answer is before I try to select an answer. Let's see, angle 1 and 2 are supplementary. All right, so let's see. Let's see what we have so far. Now, they just told us something was equal earlier, right? So we forgot to mark that up. So 2 and 3 are equal. Awesome. So we marked that up. We know that 1 and 2 are a linear pair. So that means that they make up 180 degrees. We know that 1 and 2 are supplementary. How do we know that? Is it complementary, complement theorem or supplement theorem? That'd be supplement, right? Because they make a straight line. We know that 1 and 2 make up 180 degrees. Well, it has to do something with supplementary, right? And then angle addition postulate or supplementary angles. There we go, supplementary angles, because that was what was just said to help us get there. We know that 1 and 3 are also add up to 180. Well, that has to do something with what we just did. We know that 1 and 2, so we know that 1 and 2 make 180. And we also know that angle 2 is equal to angle 3 from earlier, right? So then how do we know that angle 1 is equal to 3? Angle 1 is equal, angle 1 plus angle 3 equals 180. Well, what changed? 2 switched into 3. How do we know that? Because we changed 2 into a 3. So let's see, is that substitution, transitive, or reflexive? Okay, it's either substitution or transitive. It's one or the other. So transitive, let's see. We didn't cut out a middle man, did we? We didn't say like, oh, both of these equal 180 and the other ones also equal 180. So that's not that. So transitive property is not the option for us. It was substitute. We substituted 3 in for 2. So that would be the better choice. So that would be substitution. Boop. And then finally, angle 1 and 3 are supplementary. Now, how do you know that? What was the key word that was said? Supplementary. So that's the definition of supplementary. The other ones don't make sense. Boop. So that's the answer for that one. And one more for today. As soon as I find my mouse. All right. Sweet. Page 20, number 3. All right, so here we go. Angle 1 and angle 2 form a right angle. That was given to us. Awesome. Angle 1 and 2 are complementary. Okay, so let's think about this. So supplement theorem is totally out. It's between a definition of right angles and complement theorem. Okay, so it's between these two. Let's see. So right angles say that if they make up 90 degrees, then... So a right angle makes 90 degrees. That is the definition of right angles. Now, but complement theorem says that if two angles form a right angle, so the right angle makes complementary. That's what that says. So which one is the better choice? You had a 50-50 chance. It's complement theorem. So that's it. Okay, awesome. Angle 1 and 3 equal 90. Well, that was given to us. And they form a so 1 and 3 are complementary. Well, that has to be the theorem of complement, right? Or is that given or definition of right angles? So in this case, so they form a right angle versus they add up to 90 degrees. Okay, so that one would be definition of complementary angles or definition of right angles. So it's between the two of them now. You're like, which one is it? Which one is the better choice? So in this particular case, 50-50 chance, that would be definition of complementary angles. Okay, because what keyword was said for that to happen? That right there. So this was 90 degrees. So that would be complementary angles, right? Okay, awesome. And then 2 and 3 are congruent. Well, that's cutting out the middleman, right? So a second ago, we had that. Sorry for that. So we had 1 and 2 form right angles. Okay, so right now we have 1 and 3 make 90. And 1 and 2 also make 90, right? So that's cutting out the middle man. So that would be congruent complements theorem. And so what we never said about anything really being equal. So the only other than this one thing. So that would be complements theorem. So So that one's a little tough one. So don't feel bad if you had trouble with that. And other than that, have a great and wonderful day.